Jesus comes not for the super spiritual, but for the wobbly and the weak-kneed who know they don't have it all together and who are not too proud to accept the handout of amazing grace. It's a quote from the book called The Ragamuffin Gospel. A guy named Brennan Manning wrote that book. Great book. I'm semi going through the book as we preach this next sermon series, this sermon series here in week two. Encourage you to get that book if you like. It's maybe a little PG-13, so just kind of be aware of that. But it's good stuff overall. So, you know, when we finally see all the ragamuffins who've made it to heaven, it's not just going to surprise us. It's probably going to downright unsettle us. The guest list will include faces we never expected to see. And honestly, it might rub some of us the wrong way. Heaven's entry log will be filled with names that many would not have voted in. Individuals whose lives on earth were messy, complicated, and far from a saintly image many hold dear. Yes, the very people society often shunned, the down and out, the doubted, the ones who barely made it through the church door because they were being judged by others. We'll see them there. We'll see the rebels with tarnished past who embrace grace in their final hours, standing alongside those who live quiet, righteous lives. Grace blows my mind, and it defies all logic and all expectations. And heaven will showcase this grace. It will. Yes, sir. And it will also showcase the power of forgiveness and the depth of God's scandalous love. It will. Heaven's going to be the most beautiful mix of souls, saints and sinners alike, who are all saved by grace. We looked at that verse last week in Ephesians. We'll look at it one more time, and we're going to go to the next part of that verse later on in this message today. But Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says this, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God." It is not a result of works, so that no one may boast. This, folks, is God. This is God. Grace is God. God is love. It's time for us as Christians, as people, as humans, to begin to start to see God for who he really is. You know, over time, I've noticed that many people, many believers have started to imagine God in such a way that's a lot more like them than the vast, all-loving God that we hear about in the Bible. And the version that we often come up with of God that's in our mind often is pretty limited. We often shape our God to fit our own views. And we even create custom gods. Some of us serve the rule enforcer God, right? Or he's watching every move. He's all about punishing you when you misstep. Some of us like the genie God. God's like a vending machine, right? Do certain things, you get what you want. Some of us like the nationalist God, and we think that God prefers a certain culture or a certain country or group of people over another. Some of us like the echo chamber God that agrees with everything we believe and never challenges us. Some of us serve the fair weather friend God. He seems loving when times are good, but absent when they're not. And here's a big one. Some of us serve the God of retribution, the false God of retribution, I'd say, that keeps a tally of rights and wrongs as if life's a game. that he gives blessing and punishments only based on how we act. Also, some of us like a self-help type God. It promises material success for faith. Some of us see God as a distant, impersonal type God that only listens to big prayers, and there's nowhere to be found in daily concerns. And lastly, some of us subscribe to an angry God that doesn't give second chances, that's all about judgment. But I would tell you, folks, God's wrath for the believer has been satisfied. He put all that on his son, Jesus Christ, and it's done. All of these ideals miss the mark on some level. Folks, God is a holy God. He is a just God, but he is a personal God. He is a caring God. He is a compassionate God. He is a loving God. He is a grace-giving God, and he is a forgiving God. Some people have a hard time accepting that God can, will, and wants to forgive them. We think that our mistakes are too big to be forgiven. But this is not the God of the Bible, and this is not the God of grace. This God that we're talking about, the real God, he is the God that says this in 1 Timothy. Paul says, I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Ask God to help them. Intercede on their behalf. We did that today. And give thanks for them. Pray this way for kings and all who are in authority so that we can live peaceful and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. This is good and pleases God our Savior. Who wants what? He wants everyone to be saved and understand the truth. That's the Father's heart. For there is one God, only one mediator who can reconcile God and humanity. The man, you hear me? The man, he's the man. Christ Jesus. I'll just leave right there. That's it. I gotta turn my hat backwards for this rest of this stuff. The true God reaches out to sinners. He reaches out to ragamuffins like me, like you. That's all of us. The true God of grace is far bigger, more loving, and more inclusive, dare I say, than the versions people come up with. Friends, God is not a God who is waiting around to catch you doing something wrong. He has better things to do. But he's there all the time when we need him the most. He has our backs even whenever we err. He's more than a loving father, or he's more like a loving father that never loses their cool and understands that kids will often end up getting dirty, that kids will often end up doing some stupid stuff. He gets that. Some of us, I think, are harder on ourselves than God is on us. There's various reasons for that, but I think that's a fact. This is the God of grace. He's not always looking for a reason to punish you. Grace shows us a God who'd rather join in our celebrations than stand on the sidelines watching, waiting for us to slip up. Grace flips the script on fear. For you, for me, for all of us, why not, instead of focusing on our slip-ups, how about we begin to focus on God who's in the trenches with us? God knows our flaws. He knows your flaws and my flaws. But he loves you all the same. He knows you have failed. He knows you will fail and will fall, but he's always there to pick you back up. Yes, this Christian life, this journey of faith that we are on, is way more than just dodging sin at every turn. At least some of us think that. That's what this is all about. I'm just trying to not sin, right? It's way more than that, folks. It's about living in the truth that there is one true God who loves his people with the most passionate, loyal, amazing love that the universe has ever known. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Amazing love. How can it be? Let that sink in. Can we let that just soak into our soul this morning? That God loves us that much. Can we just stop for a minute and pay attention to this love that God has for us? It's a miracle, folks. Job 37:14 says this. God tells Job. Actually, as Job's friend tells him this. Pay attention to this, Job. Stop and consider the wonderful miracles of God. It is a miracle that God loves us the way that he does. It's a miracle that God gives us grace. You know, Job is an interesting character. One day we'll do a series over Job. He really is. Job begins to question God, and along verse 30, or chapter 32, 37, 38, somewhere around in there, starts questioning God. Job's a great guy. The Bible says that. Like, he's a pretty good dude. And God brings all this, or allows all this suffering to happen to him, and he loses everything. You probably heard the story before. I won't go through it too much. But he endured this really, really intense suffering. And he begins to wonder, why me? What have I done to deserve this stuff? He doesn't get it. He kind of thinks in his mind that he has it all together, just a little bit. And his friend shows up, a couple friends show up, first off, trying to figure out why he's suffering. They were wrong. This other guy shows up. In 32 to 37, I think it is. And really kind of speaks some truth into Job's life. It basically tells him, listen, Job, even though you are living a pretty good life, even you still don't have it all together. You still are deserving of any bad thing or any wrath of God that comes towards you. Even you. There's nothing that Job did to deserve God's blessing. As Job is kind of sulking in these chapters. He thought he did for a minute. That's really the opposite of, we talk about what a ragamuffin is. A ragamuffin is somebody who understands that they don't deserve God's blessing. That they don't have it all together. And that's okay, because they serve a God that does. And a God that loves them. And they've come to that point in their life where they realize that. So it all comes undone, and Job begins to question God, and God answers Job powerfully in Job chapter 38 and asks Job 77 questions about things like space, astronomy, the ocean, the weather, that he can't answer and nobody can answer. It's a pretty good read if you haven't read it before. Kind of puts Job in his place. I wonder if you've considered that. If you've considered the majesty and the grandeur of the things that God's created. You know, there's more stars than there are grains of sand on the earth. You know that? God created that. Each one of those stars is a sun to someplace out there. Pretty crazy. How about the speed of light? You ever thought about that? There are stars out there so big it makes our sun look like a tiny dot. And God did that without sweating. The moon is exactly the right size and at the right distance to create things like solar eclipses, where it covers the sun perfectly, giving scientists the chance to study the sun's atmosphere. There are so many galaxies out there. We can't count. There's actually two galaxies, ours, the Milky Way, and another one called the Andromeda, that are on a crash collision course that eventually will slowly crash in each other in 4 billion years, scientists say. But because the stars are so spread out, they'll mostly miss each other. It's like God planned a dance in space. How about us, DNA, living things? DNA is crazy in and of itself, isn't it? This minuscule molecule within us serves as a blueprint for all of our individual identities. And it contains instructions far more complex than the most sophisticated computer software. Wow. Each living thing possesses its own DNA sequence. It's like God autographed all of us himself. The human brain that we have is nuts. It's the most complex thing we know of in the universe. 86 billion neurons, each connecting to thousands of others, like the ultimate supercomputer, and you carry it around in your head. God designed that. God created that so we could think and dream and create and love. What an incredible gift. When you take a step back and you think about all this, how vast, how complex, how beautifully designed everything is, from the farthest star to the smallest part of our DNA, it's clear that we as humans are part of something huge. Amen. David says this in the Psalms in chapter 8, verses 3 through 9. Let's read it real quick. He says, "When I look at the night sky and I see the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals or humans that you should even think about them? Human beings that you should care for them. Yet you made them only a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You gave them charge of everything you made, putting all things under their authority, the flocks and the herds and all the wild animals, the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, and everything that swims in the ocean currents. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name. It fills the earth." And all this crazy stuff and all the vastness of the universe and all the creation of God, he cares about each one of us individually. That is truly mind-blowing. Do you get that this morning? That's mind-blowing. I think for some of us, we don't really get that. We forget it. And what's needed today is a shift in our mentality. I want to read the next part of Ephesians 2, verse 10. We've already read the first part. By grace you've been saved through faith. Verse 10 says this. What's it say? "For we are God's masterpiece." That's me. That's you. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. I got a video I want you guys to watch. We're going to get ready to close here in just a few minutes. Go ahead, guys.
Ephesians 2:10 says we are God's masterpiece. I don't know about you, but when I look in the mirror, I don't see a masterpiece, but I want to. So I go to God and I pray, "Dear Heavenly Father, would you do whatever it takes to mold me into the image of your Son? Make me your masterpiece. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen."
Hi.
Oh, who are you?
I'm God. You said the prayer, so here I am. That's how it works.
You're not God.
No, I am.
Okay, if you're God, what does Lamentations 15:9 say?
Lamentations is a very short book. It only has 5 chapters.
Why is it so short?
I was tired of lamenting.
You are God. What's that about?
These are the tools I'm going to use to make you into my original masterpiece. This is the process.
I thought you were a carpenter.
That's my son. Let's get busy. Okay. I'm going to bring up things in your life that don't belong in your life. And start right here. Your anger.
Ow!
I created the emotion, but you use it in the wrongest of ways. You compare yourself to others instead of me. And you lie. You tell little white lies. You're so afraid of confrontation. You're becoming a people pleaser. Okay,
time out. I think you've done some really good work, and I'm looking pretty good right now.
When you look in the mirror, who do you see?
I see me.
Okay, then I need to keep chiseling away because ultimately you and other people need to see my son.
Okay, but when I look like Jesus, people get uncomfortable and I don't think I'm supposed to do that.
So what you're saying is you'd rather play God in certain areas of your life than for me to be God over your whole life.
No, what I'm saying is you've grown me to here. Maybe we take a break from each other for a while, all right? And then I'll stay here and then you come back and we can grow some more.
You never just take a break from me. You're either moving toward me or away from me, but you never just plateau. What you're doing is called control. Do you want to control things in your life, or can I chisel? Control, chisel, control, chisel.
No, chisel.
All right, here we go.
Can we chisel where I want?
That's called control.
Okay, sorry.
This right here, that secret sin, that thing that you run to whenever you're hurting, you're angry, you're lonely, you're tired. Do you want to keep rearranging this in your life, or do you want me to chisel it out?
Chisel it.
It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. It's your whole life.
This hurts, okay? I don't think you understand this pain.
Don't talk to me about pain. I know all about pain. I sent my son to die on the cross for pain, for sin, but also did it for another reason, to give you freedom. Do you know what insanity is? Insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again, expecting different results. And there are things that you are doing in your life that are insane. Allow me to chisel them out of your life.
I know, but I've let you down so many times, God.
No. You were never holding me up.
Okay, then chisel away. But just be prepared for what you're gonna find in there, because I know who's inside there. God, I get up every morning and I hate what I see in the mirror, because inside is a scared, stupid kid. And I try, but I can't be who everybody else expects me to be. God, I can't even be who I wanna be, much less who you created me to be. So chisel away and just know what you're gonna find in there.
You have listened to so many voices, so many critics for far too long that are not from me, and you've bought into the lie. You think you're junk, don't you? When you lay your head down at night, at the end of the day, you think you're junk. I don't take time to make junk. I want to show you something about my love. Reach in your back pocket.
This is it's a page from a notebook when I was in college. How'd you get this?
Hello?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead and read it.
Dear God, did I hear you right? You said you were going to use me. But I feel really useless. But if you can take this life, this mess of a life I have, and do with it what you want, I love you, God.
I love you, too. And I love you too much just to leave you where you're at.
It's gonna be tough.
Yes, but you bought into the lie thinking everything was gonna be easy when you said yes to me. There will be trouble in this world, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. I want you to do something. I want you to look out there and I want you to say, Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Tommy is God's?
No, not the way you see yourself or you try so desperately for others to see you. But maybe for the first time in your life, the way I made you, the way I created you.
Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Yes, you are.
And so are you. You are an original masterpiece.
Jordan is God's original masterpiece. Noah is God's original masterpiece. Sam, you're God's original masterpiece. You are. Valerie, you are too. Joe, Matthew, you're God's original masterpiece. Megan, God's original masterpiece. Genesis tells us in chapter 1, early on, I'm not going to read it, I'm just going to tell you. You know what it says, that God made you in his own image. That's a big stinking deal. You hear me? That's a big deal. He didn't make dogs in his own image, or the mountains in his own image, or the star or the sun. He made you in his own image. We think God was flexing whenever he made, name your favorite scenic view, Niagara Falls, the mountains in Colorado. He was really flexing when he made you. You are God's original masterpiece. Ragamuffin. What a tragedy. We don't see ourselves that way. We look at God's creation and it blows us away, the stars, the mountains. But we look at ourselves and we are less than enthusiastic. That's not how God wants it, folks. It's not. You were made in His image and you're more than just a small part of everything. The same power that made the stars, the moon, the mountains, the ocean, made you. And we're not just a part of creation. We're special. We're loved by God. And you are loved by God this morning. If you're in this room today and you never accepted that love, God's love, today's the day for you. For the first time, you can come to Him. You don't have to clean up, take a bath, take a shower. As you are, you can come to Him. I'm going to invite our prayer team to come forward. And I'm going to say a prayer. And when I say amen, Noah and team back here are going to sing a song, a little bit, a few verses of the song we sang earlier. And if you got some stuff in your life you need to deal with, come on. Here they are. You may just want to come here in the front and pray. Have at it. You may want to make the choice today for the first time to accept Jesus Christ. These folks would love to pray with you about that. Don't waste this opportunity. You're not promised anything. Today's the day. This is the day that could change your life. On this day that you lost an hour of sleep and you came up here, God is here to meet you in this moment. Let's pray. Father, we love you. And we thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy toward us. It blows my mind. And the fact that you are mindful of me, that you know about me, that you care about me, is crazy. God, I have blown it, and I blow it, and we all blow it all the time. But God, you love us still. And you're compassionate towards us. So I pray in this room, if there's anybody under the sound of my voice that has not made the choice to trust Jesus Christ with their life, to give their life to Christ, and today they would do that. If you're in this room today and you want Jesus, very simply, all you've got to do where you sit is pray this prayer or something like it. God, I know I'm a sinner. God, I know I'm a ragamuffin. I'm dirty. I've blown it. I messed up. I'm weak. But I come to you an all-knowing, all-powerful, a strong God, but a loving God, a kind God. And I come to you this morning and I say, I want you in my life. I want Jesus Christ. I believe that He came and lived on this earth. He died for me to make a way to be in right standing with you, the Father. So Jesus, Holy Spirit, would you come make a home in my heart today? Would you change my life? If you prayed that prayer, we believe that Christ is now coming to your life. For the rest of us in this room, even believers, today God is reminding you of how He thinks about you and how He sees you and how He loves you. Maybe today you need to come back to God. You need to turn from the negative thoughts that you have about yourself, the self-esteem issues. God doesn't see you that way. So Father, as we enter this time of reflection, I pray, God, that you would help us to move freely in Jesus' name. Amen. If we could have the lights down, let's sing, guys.